I thought it would be helpful, since we can see then now, to see now. And with some help, I put together this little introduction of the entrance to the drawing in here in this slide with Saul LeWitt and Manzoni standing on a pedestal. And off in the background, you can see Hannah Darboven's Ulysses written out, and it's in those two panels on the wall. Can we go to the next? Yeah. And then looking to the other side, there is a long folded line drawing by James Lee Byers, which was part of the MoMA collection at that time, and the Manzoni was too. And as we come to the next, and you're Robert Smithson's slate grind drawings, also in this entrance to the exhibition, which is the main entrance to the museum at that time. And they're on pedestals. They, in fact, we got Smithson's permission to put them on the pedestals because logically they should be just on the ground, but we were afraid people would start kicking them around, which is the curator's fear at all times, that when you have an unrecognizable object, someone will stand on it or sit on it or do something else to get close to it. Next, there's a close-up of the Manzoni line, as close as anyone is ever going to get to it unless they destroy it. It's what, I can't remember the number of meters, but it's a part of a series of works that Manzoni did measuring parts of the world with a line, and then he had a roller, and he would roll it, and there was a pen, and it would make a line on this roll, and then the roll would be sealed. So, and it was it measured the earth at various places around the circumference.
So the line is inside
the line. The paper with the line
inside
is inside of that. Next, and then going back into the exiting the front hall toward the right in those days was something called the East Wing, and this is an installation of the East Wing of Darboven, and in the back a Carl Andre, what do they call those endlessly loops? Yes, Mobius strip, and a couple of other drawings of poetry, actually poetry by Andre, that he did as drawings. And here is going now out of there toward the main exhibition gallery is Rauschenberg's A Race to Kooning, which of course is not visible. It's the one on the right. And going, then passing the windows, going to the garden, you can just see the reflection of it. And actually this is flopped. So on to the next one. And this is Robert Morris. And the way he did this was he pulled a paper out and he walked across doing his hands this way on the wall. And when he ran, when it gets lighter, it's because he ran out of ink. And so that you see every time he had to stop to refresh his handprints and his footprints down the long corridor, and at the end of the corridor, you see Jasper Johns' diver Diver 2 is about hand and foot coordination. And so, in a sense, those two things set an idea of the exhibition and the feeling of space and the expansion of space and how touch and sight are related, one aspect of what one thinks about in drawing. And then next up, Jasper John's drawings behind that wall. And the idea of the exhibition is, you see, this whole wall is Jasper John's. And one of the ideas of the exhibition, which couldn't be done in this kind of beautiful choice of extraordinary pictures, although there were some beautiful drawings there, was to give an overview in the period during the exhibition from 55 to 74 of what the artists were actually doing. So there was a representation of the career, in a sense, or if not the career, the differences in media, the differences in approach to drawing in each grouping, except when, with like Dorothea's drawing, which occupied a whole wall. So it was a little bit of a democratic idea of representing the artists, but also of the change from the small drawing on the sheet of paper to an entirely different idea of space and the space that drawing occupied in terms of topography in some cases, like as with Dorothea's drawing, onward. And what I'm doing now is I'll just give you an overview view of various drawings. These are Boyce drawings, a whole group of them, mostly from the Kunstmuseum Basel, and then going on through these groundbreaking ideas of the small drawing and the drawing that's contained on the sheet, onward to finding other modes of expression in drawing. And here, a Twombly, which was not in the exhibition, but is now in the MoMA collection, and it speaks very eloquently of a drawing on a sheet of paper that is not done according to a traditional aesthetic. So onward with that, I'll go into that later. Dorothea's drawing is right there, that seemingly blank wall. And those are two drawings that Bob Ryman made for the show. Some of these drawings were made for the show on site, and some of the walls were built to accommodate drawings, like this Richard Serra, which is called Abstract Slavery. And I asked Richard what the title was about, and it is not about racism. It's just that at that time, that drawing was made with a small paint stick, stroke by stroke by stroke, and it felt like slavery to him and to his. So, and then the loop there, I had a room of representations of earth drawings that's Mike Heiser. I forget what you call that.
Depression.
Circumflex. It was a circumflex. And it was drawn into the earth. And then this is in the last part of the exhibition, were sculptors' drawings and drawings made for giving drawing to a fabricator or something like that. So there was also the idea of showing different aspects of drawing that hadn't been given up. So that takes care of drawing now.
Okay, it's strange because drawing then is now, and drawing now is them. See, I hadn't seen these photographs before this evening, and what strikes me is not only how beautiful the show must have been, I wasn't able to see it, I lived in Europe at the time, but how similar it feels in a certain way to parts of this exhibition. That shouldn't be so surprising. I thought I might just tell you a little bit about the background how it came about that I did this show for Dominique. I've known Dominique for more than 20 years. We were friends in London many, many years ago, and she often said to me, I'd love you to come and do something at the gallery. I was working for 4 or 5 years on the catalog raisonné of the Jasper Johns drawing, as Emilio said, and I wasn't free to do that. Last summer, we were talking about it again, and she said, please think of something you can do, absolutely anything that you would like to do, and the gallery will support you with assistance and our staff. Their staff is extraordinary. And I thought I would tell you just very briefly about my life in the 60s. In 1960, I turned 16, and in 1969, I turned 26. And between those years, I finished high school. I got a degree in art history at the University of California at Berkeley and was active in the student riots. I then went to Europe for a year, came back and got a degree in art history from Columbia, once again active in the student riots. Went to Washington, marched on Washington. I mean, they were very, very, very extraordinary years. The assassinations of the Kennedys and Martin Luther King, the war in Vietnam. And by the end of the 60s, I had decided that I would try to make my professional life related to art. And I got a job as a reporter in the art department of Life magazine. And being a reporter at Life magazine opened incredible doors. I mean, it was a very powerful publication, and any phone call that you made saying, I'd like to come and visit you, I'm a reporter at Life magazine, opened wonderful doors for me. And I interviewed a lot of people, including Richard Serra, Eva Hesse, Keith Sonnier, Rauschenberg, Johns, and people like that. So that's how I sort of got started in the 60s. And when Dominique said, you can really do anything you want, I thought it would be interesting for me to look back 50 years, more than 50 years in some cases, a little less than 50 years if you look at the whole decade, and look at the drawings that I saw then and think about how their influence made a difference to younger generations of artists in the following decades. And I'd like to point out a couple of ways in which this exhibition and the MoMA exhibition, Bernice's exhibition, are different. We realized, obviously, when we started that this is a gallery and it's not a museum. So we had certain limitations because of that, the size and our access to certain kinds of drawings. That was something that was different. We had limited our artists to Bernice's exhibition had included European artists. And also photographs. That was a photograph of the earthwork.
That was a representation
right.
of an earthwork because obviously you couldn't have an earthwork.
Right.
But I'll talk about that after.
Yeah. So that was one thing. On the press has sort of explained it a little bit incorrectly, I think. We were not in any way trying to recreate that exhibition. In fact, there's not a single drawing in this exhibition, not one out of the 70 drawings that was in that exhibition. Although there are about half the artists who were represented in this exhibition were in the exhibition, and about half of the artists weren't. I have a list of the artists that are represented here that were not in that exhibition, and I thought it might be interesting to read that to you. Some of the artists who weren't represented at that time were making art, obviously, because their drawings are here, but had not really been recognized for one reason or another. Perhaps they were still in school, perhaps they were far from New York, perhaps they had jobs to support themselves and didn't have a gallery representing them. So it's not unusual that there were many, many artists whose work weren't known at the time. And of course, every exhibition involves choices, and I'm sure your exhibition involved choices, as did ours. We started with a list of over 120 artists, and then we began to pare it down and to think about work by artists that was really innovative and really almost revolutionary, as the artists that you included also were. So that, for example, you can think of a great draftsman like Jim Dine, who made the most beautiful drawings. But they weren't drawings that changed the notion of what a drawing could look like. They were really drawings in the tradition of Ingres or early Picasso or somebody like that. They were just great representational drawings. So we decided.
But if I could interrupt you for a moment, they were great representational drawings, almost Ingres-like in his. Mm. But they were of tools. They weren't of beautiful people.
That's true. In that sense, they weren't like anchor. Well, they were tools and bathtubs and, I mean, bathrobes and other things.
Yeah, well, no bathrobes by then, but yeah.
And I wanted, in picking the drawings, it to be very clear that these were drawings from the 60s. I wanted the visitor to walk in the room and to know, looking around, that none of these drawings could possibly have been done in the 50s. So we didn't include de Kooning, for example, who was still making great drawings in the 60s, but very different kinds of drawings. And I also didn't want it to be a show now looking back 50 years of just masterpieces of drawing of the 60s. So we purposely didn't include a John's flag, for example. We purposely didn't include a Liechtenstein comic book image. I wanted the drawings to be not well known, slightly uncharacteristic, if possible, of the draftswoman, so that the viewer really looks at the drawings, that you can't just come into the room and say, oh, there's one of those, there's one of these, there's one of these, but you actually sort of look at the drawing and say, is that Frank Stella? That looks like Frank Stella, but it doesn't look quite like the Frank Stella that I know. So those were some of the things that were in my mind as we chose the drawings. And of course, we had certain constraints. Most museums need to have a long period of time before they'll lend you something, and we started quite late. So there were museums like the Art Institute of Chicago, for example, whose drawings department has great, great American drawings of the 60s, but we knew that we were too late to ask for their help. We hoped that MoMA and the Whitney would help us out because we figured, well, they're local and they're only, you know, 20 blocks away or 50 blocks away, and Carter very, very kindly did help us out and lend us some great drawings, and MoMA also helped us out and was able to lend us a couple of drawings. And then we also approached certain artists, and they were also very generous. So we started out with a nucleus of Ellsworth Kelly agreed to lend us some of his drawings, and Jasper Johns agreed to lend us some of his drawings. We were able to borrow drawings from Bryce Marden from the Liechtenstein Foundation, and we began to build a sort of impressive group of drawings to start with. And once we had that, as a gallery, it's obviously much more difficult to borrow drawings from private collections than it is if you're a museum. But private collectors were very generous with us. And once we were able to say to them that we had managed to obtain beautiful drawings from the Whitney, MoMA, and some artist collections, they were very generous. So I just want to read you, I think it's quite interesting. I'll just read you this list very quickly of the artists who were in this exhibition who were not included in the MoMA exhibition. Albers, Joe Baer, Bontecue, Via Selmans, Agnes Dennis, Barry LeVay, Lee Lozano, Barnett Newman, Adrian Piper, James Rosenquist, Rouchet, David Smith, Michelle Stewart, Paul Tech, Anne Truitt, Wayne Thiebaud, John Wesley, and Wesselman. And I do want to point out, because I'm quite proud of this, that 8 of the artists on this list who were not in the MoMA show are women. And that was something that we tried very hard to make sure happened. But there were a lot of great artists and there were a lot of great drawings that we weren't able to include. This is only a small selection. But I feel as though it has a certain, it holds together very well. The two floors are very different. This is a very different feeling upstairs than it is downstairs where the pop drawings are and the Johnses, Rauschenbergs, and Twombleys are. But that's sort of the basic feeling that we had going into it and getting it organized.
And it's a very beautiful exhibition, but as you can tell, very different from an exhibition with a polemic to explore. At the time Drawing Now was developed, the MoMA had just established its own independent drawing department. It was 1971. And I had previously worked in the drawing and print department, and then after that in the painting and sculpture department at MoMA, and left the painting and sculpture department to work with Bill Lieberman in establishing this new drawing collection, which then separated from the print collection. And the so-called drawing collection at MoMA was very traditional in a certain sense, in that it was primarily made up of drawings in pencil, pen and ink, and black and white, dry and wet media. When the department was established, Alfred Barr decided that he would then transfer everything on paper, including colored things, to the MoMA drawing collection. And we began with those things that the museum already owned. We had very little money, and Bill Lieberman was in charge of acquisitions, and he built an extraordinary support collection of European modern masters, and it was, in a sense, it was what we were able to do, but it was prescient in that nobody could again do this. And so we went on like that for a while, and meantime I was out in the streets, and I was seeing artists' work, and I developed the idea for this exhibition, and we have a great system at the museum. One of our chief benefactors in doing these kinds of exhibitions, and still is the International Council of the Museum of Modern Art. And so they put up money for research to go to Europe and to find these drawings, once I said that we're looking at a totally different situation from what's reflected in our collection and from what is considered the norm for drawings. And there were all sorts of books about it. MoMA's idea of drawings came out of Harvard, Paul Sachs, Monroe Wheeler, who came out of Paris and was a great publisher of books and prints and drawings. And the first drawing that came to MoMA years and years before had been given by Paul Sachs. It was a portrait of Gross's mother-in-law, Anna Peter. And we always joked, poor Gross, because the first drawing, we very frequently put it in the gallery as an introduction to all the other drawings. And meanwhile, I was working on this show, and I was and there, as I said, Harvard, there was John Pope, who had written this whole treatise on what constitutes a drawing, from dry medium to wet mediums, and to mediums where there is painterly ink and so forth and so on. And that was the extent of what a drawing constituted. And then a very wonderful analysis by another person whose name I can't remember and couldn't find, of how drawing is meant to flow, and the line is meant to be graceful as it goes around the contours and so forth. And this was not the exciting kind of drawing that I was looking at out there on the streets and in artist studio. They were doing something completely different. So this exhibition arrived on this scene, and it was a contemporary art exhibition, because what I had noticed and what I had learned from the artists that I was talking to is that they had a completely different sense of drawing, and that drawing was about the things that you saw on the walls there, about a topological analysis, as I said, in Dorothea's work, but also the difference of materials, the difference of grounds. For instance, to draw on a wall, as in Saul LeWitt's case, but not as there's a Saul LeWitt drawing here, but when Saul LeWitt says dimensions variable, he means the directions. He came to mean that the dimension that was variable was the wall itself, not the drawing, so that the drawing conformed to the available wall and was planned for the available wall. So these and they were compared to the Sinopia of frescoes and that sort of thing, but in reality they were full-fledged and very beautiful atmospheric transformations of the spaces in which they were drawn, and they followed a set of logical rules, and how different sets developed out of the basic sets, and the variations on them were according to very strict conceptual rules, although the conceptual rules proved to be a little wacky if you carried them too far. So all sorts of things could come out of these rules, these simple rules, and LeWitt's whole development is about this kind of variation. So that in the catalog, I made very clear that this was not the only kind of drawing being done, but this was the kind of drawing that interested me the most. So that if there were exceptions, they were, to my mind, not people who were pushing the parameters, not just pushing them, overturning them, insisting on something different, insisting that something, some different aesthetic was at work, but not just a different aesthetic, a whole new way of looking at the world and looking at the world of art, and that drawing was a very important way of looking at this new world of art, which and at that time sculpture was very, very interesting, and a lot of these drawings were sculptural in a certain way that it's difficult to describe for me right at this moment. But even the Rauschenbergs were sculptural because they spoke of a different kind of space on the page and a different, they were elicited differently from the way one normally goes about getting images, taking an image from a magazine and drawing over it with something that would dissolve it, and choosing heroic subjects. If you look at in the back behind you, if you'll move away from the Jasper Johns drawing, that's an extraordinarily sculptural drawing in the sense that I mean. It's above the page, even though Rauschenberg, the medium sat in the page, there was something about them that came out at you. And that Twombly that I showed to you, there was something about that incredible, controlled, scribbling and scoring and going wild. In fact, it's much more wild than Jackson Pollock in its way. And yet it makes an extraordinary statement about how far you can push a line that isn't really describing anything. And so that I was looking for drawings that violated all of these rules and took a traditional aesthetics and said, no, we have our own way of making lines. We have our own space. And so that while there were many worthy artists doing beautiful drawings, that was not my primary interest, although I did think that all of these things were very beautiful.
Can I ask you a question? Obviously, what you were trying to do completely succeeded. I mean, you know, everything that happened in drawing after that was really transformed by that exhibition, in a sense, by the recognition of the importance of those drawings.
Well, it was the artists who were doing it.
Well,
I was recording.
Right. But how was it received at the time? What kinds of reviews did you get for the exhibition?
Well, I've been reading to Kate and to Dorothy and Phyllis and to Dan the Hilton Kramer review of the exhibition. I imagine that you're laughing because some of you have read it. In which,
imagine.
Excuse me?
We can just imagine.
Oh, you're just imagining. You can't imagine this. Because at one point he said, how are we to distinguish from our, hygienic task with the toilet roll paper?
He literally said, how can we distinguish these drawings from toilet, the way we use toilet paper? He
paper
literally
in
said
our
that.
Daily hygiene or something, yeah. So that's pretty unimaginable. It made John Russell, who was a senior critic at the Times, very angry. And so he wrote something, I don't know if the Times had done before or after, but he mounted a rebuttal the following week in which he said it was the most useful, the most beautiful exhibition that the MoMA had ever done. Something of an overstatement, to say the least, but he was so incensed by the toilet paper that and so on, although Hilton did like the catalog, which he said was the best description of the aesthetic of the 60s and 70s that he had read. So evidently, he thought although he said although he was basically saying that he challenged me to define a drawing and make some parameters for it, because in essence, what I saw was artists who were pushing every parameter, and we couldn't, of course, have an earth drawing given the limitations of the MoMA gallery, although the Menil does have an earth drawing outside its building, a small one. And Mike Heiser had done an etched glass drawing, which was in the exhibition. It fit into a window looking out on the garden.
Isn't that sort of what the whole exhibition was about, really, was that a drawing is whatever an artist decides he wants it to be. He can make it out of any material. He can put it onto any surface. It can be on plaster, on plastic, on earth. And that was, in a way, what was so revolutionary about the drawings that were made in the 60s and that you cataloged in your show.
Well, yes, but it's not just about the surface or what you can do with the surface, because I was very influenced in my reading by someone called John Rawson, who is a British historian who wrote about drawing, and he wrote about drawing in a very different way from the way most people did, and he analyzed drawing in a different way, and he talked about historic references, like drawing on, like the drawings on Greek urns, the drawings on cave walls, and all the possible places that drawings could be, so that I was aware that that was always a possibility in drawing, and that artists, the French Academy had decided what a drawing was, or the Italian tradition had decided what a drawing was, and had foreclosed all of these possibilities, and artists were opening them up again.
I think Duchamp obviously had a huge influence on the whole sense of what an object could be, what a drawing could be, what any work of art could be.
Well, he had certainly opened everything up to question. You're right. And so what I was trying to do, and as I look at the show again 40 years later, because I hadn't even realized it was 40 years until some critic said, here is the 40th anniversary of this exhibition, and I thought it can't be. But so the idea was not that I was overturning it. I was simply recording what extraordinary artists were doing that was turning something over and creating something entirely new, even when it was on paper.
And Mick, can I ask you, once you had mounted the exhibition, did the drawings department at MoMA begin to collect drawings by these artists?
Not out of this exhibition, but it did open up collecting for us. We were a very, very small department at that time, and we didn't have a great deal of money. I mean, to say the least, we had to raise every dollar ourselves. We had no endowment. We had no real funds. And it wasn't always possible for us to get what we exhibited.
But I guess what I really mean is, did those who did support the drawings department recognize that this kind of drawing should be part of the collection of the museum?
Well, slowly we began to collect this way. But also I have to say that there were numerous articles about this going on. And there was a show that Rosalind Krauss did that was at Princeton, and unfortunately, a lot of people didn't get to see it, which was extremely beautiful and very, very concentrated on the fruit of all of this, instead of having the small drawings that I had. For instance, one of the reasons I asked Robert Morris to do a wall drawing was she had an extraordinary wall drawing by Robert Morris in that exhibition. She had she had some really very radical drawings there and very concentrated, and I think one can maybe find catalogs of that exhibition because it was very important in my thinking. And there were people like Kynaston McShine who was involved in the new ideas. I went to Cologne and I went to Dusseldorf and to places where European collectors were collecting American things of this sort when Americans were not supporting it. So that recognition was happening and artists were working in marvelous earthquakes, Robert Morris in Holland, the Sonspeak exhibition. Mönchengladbach as a center for a really radical drawing. At that time, I saw extraordinary pencil drawings by Richter, and I didn't understand them at all. So much was happening that was exciting that one would have, as a curator, one would have had to be very cosseted not to understand that there was something very exciting going on. And when I look back at the show, I think of ways in which I could have done better. And I'm not going to say what they are, because yeah. So.
Well, I think what you did was pretty extraordinary. I thought it might be interesting to answer questions if anybody would like to ask a question.
I have a question.
Carter.
I just wonder what gave you the idea for the exhibition initially, or did anything, or was it just the fact that you felt like there was something revolutionary going on specifically in using drawing?
It was just, I saw something that was happening, and as a curator at MoMA, it was our duty as contemporary curators to report on these kinds of things. One of the rules we had at MoMA then, and I think we still there, is that you, if you want to do an exhibition, you are required to cast new light on your subject. And this one was hitting me over the head. So, and as I said, like Kynaston McShine was right there with the painting and sculpture all the time, so we were challenging one another in a sense.
So the idea about drawing then, I mean, not on the show, but just in general, the perception about drawing at that time in history was much more old-fashioned, we could say.
Well, institutionally it was. Out in artist studios, in the streets, it was radically different.
Was there resistance?
No, no, no. There was. It took me a long time to get it on the schedule, but that had to do more with how much time and how much space a drawing exhibition could take up, as opposed to a painting and sculpture exhibition. That's an entirely different problem. And the museum was much smaller than it is now, and so you, as a drawing curator, you may not know that these days, because, and we were still sharing the gallery
the collections gallery between drawings and prints, even though there was a drawing department. So
it was wonderful to see those images. Those are the best.
Yeah.
They looked amazing.
They looked amazing to me, too. I can't believe it.
I have a question. You know, I think both your exhibition, which at least in images and in the catalog, I studied very intensely, and your exhibition, which I think is in a way revisiting that moment in a very beautiful way. What strikes me as particularly interesting is the, at least to my knowledge, relative absence of artists' writings on that particular mode of production. If you think of the 60s, there is a wealth of artists' writing on other modes of production, from Notes on Sculpture by Rob Morris, Dan Graham's writing, Donald Judd's writings, Robert Smithson's writings, and so on. But there are no kind of manifesto writings about drawing as a practice. So in a way, what you're identifying as a new approach, a kind of new methodology, a new practice through process and drawing, seems to be almost kind of outside of another form of, how can I say, theoretical or other kind of argumentation as produced by the artist.
Well, Robert Morris was writing, Mel Bachner was writing,
Smithson's Heap of Language.
Yeah. Exactly.
As a drawing, not as a text.
But I feel like what that show did was introduce a museological read or something that could be part of the dialogue, but the artists themselves were generating texts that were defined, you know, that were grappling with what they were doing, which often was writing on paper, drawing, and thinking about and these lines came. I mean, think of Lewitt's writings. They are about drawing. They're just not kind of
His verbal rules, which would sometimes be written on the drawings, and there was what's now I'm getting tired and forgetting what's his name, Lawrence Wiener. There was a text drawing in the exhibition, so a lot of what you're talking about took place within the work itself and as directions for the work. But Don Judd was writing. Of course, it wasn't specifically about drawing, but a lot of the writing by artists was, even though it wasn't about drawing, was relevant to drawing. It could be, you could read it and you would understand the larger world of drawing, even though if Judd wrote something about sculpture, he clearly was not a draftsman. In fact, I had a conversation with him.
He doesn't like drawing very much.
And no, he didn't like, I had a conversation with him because I told him I'd like to include some of his shop drawings. And he said, well, that he didn't take drawing very seriously, but if that's what I wanted to do, it was fine. So the exhibition opened, and there's that place where I showed you where they had, where I had put those kinds of drawings. And I talked to each artist about their contribution to the exhibition. And so that was what Don Judd said to me. And then I had a little conversation with Dan Flavin, in which we talked about his drawings, which were, you know, imaginary conceptions after, which were actually done by his wife most of the time. So that he said that he had a big drawing in Canada, and he wanted me to get that big drawing because he had actually done it, so I got the big drawing. And Richard Serra wanted, as I said, he wanted me to go to see this drawing, Abstract Slavery, and it was in Baltimore. And he said, you have to go to Baltimore. So I went to Baltimore. But
when the exhibition was actually on the walls, and there were these small drawings included because it was also about other people doing the drawing, given what Saul Witt was doing. They, Don and Dan and Carl Andre, had a little group that had fun making trouble about exhibitions, and they had their works taken off the floor of the Guggenheim because the Guggenheim hadn't placed Carl's work directly on the floor, but had put it on a platform, which was why I was so conscious about Smithson's on the platforms. But so Dan wrote this incredible 10-page letter to Dick Oldenburg, writing this small about why was this. So I called Donald Judd and I said, look, you told me that your drawing was very important, and the exhibition did a path like this in the main galleries. Okay, so you walk in, the first drawing was the Jasper Johns, and then it snaked around, and the last drawings were these small drawings until you came out again into the Jasper Johns and back down the corridor. So Don said to me, well, if this were a sculpture show, I would be up front and Jasper Johns would be in the back. I said, right. And that was the end of the problem. So what I'm saying is, actually, the exhibition was an extraordinary adventure for me and started a different way for me to think about things also. And so I was very thankful to, I mean, I asked Dorothea to do the work, and she came in and she did this extraordinary work. You can't see it in there, but it's a paper that was folded and then it was put on the wall, and she, well, why don't you describe it?
I'd like to ask you to talk, because I'd like to talk. I'm the only other person in this room. I'm the only other person in this room besides Bernice that was at that show.
Well, true.
To speak as an artist to you, Bernice, yes, I knew about everything that was going on, and, you know, me, Judd, and LeWitt, and other people, like, we had a group which I sort of nicknamed the Boy Scouts, because it was them and me, because I had to include a woman, you know, but I was the only one around. I think Jobert was around, but I think she was maybe in the process of going to Europe or something, moving to Ireland, which she eventually did, and then she now lives in Holland. So, you know, I knew about everything that was going on, and everybody, you know, all of us knew. They were, you know, the guys were competitive and all that stuff, but, you know, they were putting, I knew a lot about what was going on in Europe because they were putting them down. So I sort of made it my business to look up Europe, go to the library and look up European magazines and so on. So the reason I'm stating this is that you weren't just now, you know, throughout my long art life,
I'm sorry.
You weren't just recording what was going on. Throughout my long art life, I've run into this problem as the curator as creator, which is not interesting as a rule. But you really were the creator, Bernice. You really were. You saw an overall picture, and I know, you know, Kinniston had done the information show already.
I don't remember.
It was before. But, you know, so, you know, the stuff was in the air, the Live in Your Head show in Europe.
Right,
and
exactly.
You know,
yeah, that one.
It was all around. But in terms of drawing, something extraordinary, I think, from my experience, had happened. Now, I went to the Beaux-Arts, where you every month, only one piece of paper a month, and so I had a very traditional background. And when I went to Black Mountain, frankly, nobody knew how to draw. They were just kind of, you know, they, but still, when, and then when I came to New York, the artists that I knew, like Barnett Newman, were proudly saying, I don't do drawings before I make a picture, as though drawing was some kind of, you know, unsightly relative or something. Yes. I mean, this was a big statement. It wasn't just Bernie that made it. There was lots of artists. And when this began to occur about drawing, I was fascinated because I could see that something was happening, but you were the person that brought it all together. I mean, there was no big drawing show anywhere else, you know, there really wasn't. And I think in and of itself, that changed the nature of drawing. Drawing became something that young artists did, which is not what had been going on. Also, I have to say, I've since seen a lot of people do, a lot of curators do shows, and usually they work from a small model, and everything's in the model, and they pretty much follow the pattern. But Bernice, who'd been in a taxi cab accident and had back all those big drawings around by herself from wall to wall because it was a visual experience for her. And that's what you're bringing together, the show was. It was something you need to do for your own inner self. And it reflected on all of us.
Thank you so much.
I think that's what drawing always is. It's something that you need to do for yourself.
And this show shows that magnificent.
Has the same voice.
Yes, it has.
But people have said to me, you know so-and-so, what's he doing now? I said, well, he's in his studio every day making drawings. What else does an artist do until the day he dies? He doesn't say, well, I've made a lot of drawings. I'm 65 years old. I think I'll go to Florida. It's what you do because it's what you have to do. And I hope that the drawings in this show have this quality as well.
This is such a wonderful thing, you know, for you to have done because of what happened way back then.
Yes, what would you like to
ask? I wanted to ask a very different question. When I came to see this show, it's already a month or two ago, I think, when it opened, I had a feeling, and I think it was particularly on the second floor, along that wall, of anxiety. And I can't remember, you know, how I would place that, except that I walked out saying, well, there was something, anxiety was in the air at that time. You mentioned the 60s. So, and I'm also struck that if we feel a lot of anxiety in 60s art, we don't feel it in the art that we see now. I mean, I don't feel it. I never had that feeling. Now, what I was wondering was, whether you felt, I mean, you may not have this feeling of anxiety from that art, but of course we could find political roots. And those of us, I'm a little bit younger, but of course we remember the bomb, you know? I mean, we grew up planning out we were going to do our basements, you know, so that when the bomb hit, you know, we were going to still survive, you know? So there was that kind of anxiety. But I wonder if also this explosion of possibility for art was also perhaps creating an anxiety.
Well, first of all, I have to ask you, has your anxiety persisted?
Am I an anxious person?
No, I was sort of kidding. I mean, did you feel it today as well when you saw the same drawings?
I don't think it's the same on this floor. I love this Jeffrey Downs piece, it's extraordinary. I
agree this floor has a very different feeling. I wouldn't say that anxiety is the right word. I think there's always a tension. There's always some tension between what the artist is thinking, what he is doing, what he's working out, what he's trying to do again, trying to do differently. And I think if that's not there, you don't end up with a great drawing. And that may be what you're feeling. It may be a different word.
So anxiety would be a necessary condition for all good drawing.
I think that's probably true to a certain degree. I don't know, Dorothea, what do you think?
I think it depends on how you define anxiety.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, many artists work with the golden viewer. Is that another form of anxiety? I don't know.
Say that again, I think we're here.
Many artists work with a goal of beauty. Is that another form of anxiety? I don't know.
Of falling short of the goal.
No.
Well, trying to reach the goal can create some anxiety.
Yeah, I mean, did Piero della Francesca paint out of anxiety? I mean, you know, there's some work that has a lot of angst, like maybe Twombly is showing angst, although it's a very beautiful work, of course, but Francesca, his goal was to be extraordinarily beautiful in his work.
My guess is that there was enough anxiety, even in Piero della Francesca.
I think so.
You know, there's so much kinds of anxiety of just the actual making, the plaster and the perspective and all the things that he studied, grappled with, that he did in the court of Urbino that, you know, had never been done before. It may have produced a very beautiful work of art in the end, but he also had some anxiety with the, you know, the great painting of the Madonna of the Misericordia, where she's holding her cloak out and all the donors are under the cloak, and they didn't accept that, and he had problems with the contract. So, I think there was plenty of anxiety.
But
well, I mean, that's what I'm referring to. Mm. What I think you're referring to is what makes you get up in the morning as an artist to work. You know, what gets the juices going other than the coffee? Well, you know, I mean, some artists really work out of pure anxiety, and others work toward this goal of beauty.
But don't you think that?
Yeah, but it's also an artist doesn't put anxiety into the work.
No,
the art is not about copying a still life or projecting one's feelings at any particular moment. One may have those feelings, but what art is a working out, an objectification within a whole cultural set that exists out there with, and that's what he's grappling with. And if he's only she is grappling with self anxiety, and that's what the picture about. Well, it's not very interesting.
I remember I had dinner with Frank Stella in London many, many, many years ago, and he had entered a competition, oddly enough, for to design a building in Germany. It was when his paintings were beginning to come more and more off the wall, and then he had this idea for a building, and he entered a competition, and he spent a great deal of time making his maquette and doing what he was supposed to do, and he had just found out that day that he didn't win, and he was extremely upset, and he talked about the difficulties of making art, and I said, do you ever think to yourself, I don't want to do this anymore, and he paused and he said something I will never forget. He said, no, I wake up every morning of my life and I say to myself, I want to do it better. Right. And I think that's what it is. Mm-hmm. It is necessarily filled with anxiety. Well, you wake up every morning of your life and you want to do it again, so. So it's getting a little late. Anything else before we stop? Thank you very, very much.